Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode number 99 of the Rewatch Project with Hannah and Mike. And this rather neatly coincides with us completing our coverage of season 4 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. with the episode World's End, the final, the 22nd episode of season 4.
We're going to party like it's number 99.
Hey! You've been holding on to that one all day, haven't you? Moving on. Would you, Hannah, like to, with your singular wit, tell us a little bit about this episode that we're going to be covering this evening?
This episode is called World's End. The synopsis says, with the surprising emergence of Ghost Rider, Coulson and the team attempt to stop Aida from ending the world.
Wow, okay, they got their hands full.
Directed by Billy Gierhart and written by Jeffrey Bell.
Okay.
I'm excited.
Yes, well, season finales are always exciting. And indeed. I think that this is sort of, you know, it almost feels like this is a multiple season finale because you've had the sort of three separate but connected storylines and this is sort of completing the entire season. So it feels like it almost has even more gravitas behind it than we would ordinarily have. A quick little bit of housekeeping before we get into things, though. Just a quick reminder that we always appreciate feedback at rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, or you can leave us comments on our YouTube channel, where we also appreciate subscriptions, likes, shares, thumbs up, set your alerts. All this YouTube-y stuff would be good. Also, Apple Podcasts. We also appreciate reviews there, as we do on Spotify or whatever your podcast, your podcatcher of choice is. And we would also, of course, remind you to please check out our friend shows, namely The Good, The Bad and The Odd, The Iron Sequel, Entertainment Landfill, His Film, Her Movie, Film Bastards, Chinstroker versus Punter. I think that is all of them. Yes, Hannah, do we have any feedback?
We do indeed.
Okay, cool.
First bit of feedback is actually on the Mark Singer interview.
Oh, okay.
So I'm just going to read this one out. It is from Jack B. Nimble. It says, Mark should write an autobiography. He seems like a genuine person. A lot can be learned from those who remain true in spite of so many years in the business.
It's funny because I agree. I think he was a lovely guy and I'd love to do something else with him. But
He seemed really genuine on the interview.
Yeah, and the thing is that he's one of those people where a lot of actors talk about Shakespeare. That's kind of almost like, it's almost like a cliche, like, oh, I've done Shakespeare. But I think that, I don't know if I've ever heard anybody explain the appeal of Shakespeare as well as Mark Singer. Like, I really wish that he'd been a teacher in my high school.
Yeah.
Because the thing that had never occurred to me was, it's like hip-hop, it's like sort of Lin-Manuel Miranda, it's like, it's the sort of, the sport of wordplay and the cleverness of that and the way that the words echo and rhyme, but they also have double meaning and all that. Whereas I think that people tend to think of Shakespeare in this very stuffy way. And he was talking about just the sort of the joy of saying it, of speaking it, how it feels coming out of your mouth.
And I think that's one of the things, is he's not lying about his love of it.
Yeah.
Like I'm sure some actors do.
Oh, yeah. He's got like the...
He's a genuine love.
Yeah, I mean, there's stuff... I put clips in the video of like him in his 20s, you know, doing A Midsummer Night's Dream, you know, playing Mercutio and stuff like that. And but also, the thing that I really admire about him is that he will then talk about Beastmaster and V without any difference in their value.
Well, and that's pretty amazing, isn't it? Because, you know, I get the feeling that whatever he turns his hand to, he works
hard.
Yeah, and would only commit to something that he's all in on.
Yeah.
You know, so whether it's Beastmaster or V or
appearing on the Rewatch Project podcast.
Well, indeed, you know.
But well, thank you for that. It's always thank good you to very have you. But and again, that sort of is indicative of how we will share comments on things from the past.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. Don't feel
that you have
it's
to be.
It's always great to see that, you know, older episodes are still getting love on them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or just being listened to.
Absolutely. Bring it on. Right. So the next one we have is from Jason James.
Okay.
Says, hey guys, Jason from Chester, UK here. Not spoken since episode 62 when you were kind enough to encourage me to pursue my Supernatural rewatch idea.
Oh, yes, of course, the podcast, yeah.
Still not managed to get it off the ground yet, but not for lack of trying. Life has suddenly got busy for both of us recently. My friend Liam is a rabid Supernatural fan, which is where the idea came from in the first place. He named his son Jensen after Mr. Eccles.
Wow, that's dedication.
And he has the same tattoo the brothers have that prevents them being possessed. Anyway,
well, I hope it works for him too.
Yeah. Anyway, on to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Like I said before, season 4 is my favourite season. All the main characters did some of their best acting in this LMD Hydra storyline. How Brett Dalton hasn't become an action star is beyond me.
Yeah, I mean, you'd have thought he'd at least be on that the level of, like, you know, straight to video, straight to streaming kind of guy, you know.
He continues, he's so good as Ward, and I love that they found a way to bring him back again. For me, May is scarier out of the framework than in. I think it's because she's so stoic and insular in the real world while being so kick-ass, whereas inside her, quote marks, darkness, it's just taken up with her being the bad guy Hydra agent. Fitz was immense as her doctor, though, and his utter dismay after exiting the framework is palpable. Mac and Daisy's hope scene and the following scene of him getting back to the base was amazing too. Great to see Trip as well. Something I noticed in the Daisy and May escape scene last episode was that May had a gun on her at all times, whereas Daisy took a gun from a dead agent. I thought it was a subtle little change from May's usual, if I want a gun, I'll take one attitude. Anyway, guys, keep up the great work and love craft country for Sorbet.
Hmm.
And by the way, Mike, Trump was president from 2016 to 2020.
I know. When I was editing the podcast, I was like, God, yeah, I was like a year out.
Cheers, guys.
Cool.
Thank you, Jason. That was a great email or comment on YouTube. And all I can say is I wholeheartedly agree. And awesome spot about May having a gun on her when she's in the framework, because that really isn't May's mode of operation, is it?
No, like, no, you're right, you're right.
She is very like, I'll just use what I've got, and if I need anything, I'll grab it.
Yeah, and often it is those things, those sort of accoutrements that inform character.
Yeah. He's also added another comment saying, PS, a question. What is the best order to watch Star Trek programs? I've never watched any in any significant way, but have recently started the Orville. Is there an order that makes sense, or just go for it? Cheers.
I almost feel like I'd need to quiz the person first. I'd need to know how old they were.
Right.
I think that's a big factor. Because I think a younger person, there's certain Star Trek that I'd say to just avoid completely.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on their likes and what they've already seen and a lot of all of those things. That'd be the thing. But anyway, sorry, go on, you go.
I get all of that, but I think one of the problems that you have is because you are so well-versed in Star Trek, you don't just...
I think my answer might surprise you.
Well, I think you...
There's two answers to this question. Well,
okay. My answer would be, if he's enjoying the Orville, to go in to Star Trek The Next Generation.
Mm-hmm.
I would say for the first two seasons, you could pretty much cherry pick a handful of episodes. We could tell you which ones are good to watch. And then watch it every episode from season 3 on.
Hmm.
And then like, I'm basically saying in the order I watched it, which is, like, I didn't watch the original series. I watched the next... I mean, I have seen the original series before. You've seen
some of them, haven't you?
Yeah, yeah. But I watched The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine. We cherry-picked Voyager. We started watching all of them and nearly lost the will to live. So we cherry-picked, and then we watched all of Enterprise. And that was excellent from my point of view. Obviously, as well as those ones, there's obviously Discovery, Strange New Worlds. Are there any others?
Picard,
right. So,
and then there's a couple of animated shows as well.
Yeah. So from my mind, after The Next Generation, you know, it might, like, it depends what you would want out of it, but Strange New Worlds might be a good one to watch because it has that kind of episode of the week, the crew working together.
Well, I think that once somebody's watched all of The Next Generation and all of Deep Space Nine, they're in.
Yeah.
I don't think you have to worry about it after that point.
Yeah.
My feeling is there's two answers to these questions. The first answer is to watch it all in the order it was released, all of it.
Yeah.
That's completely unrealistic. But if you are going to do that, because it might just be a logistic question, because there are different orders of episodes. There's the airing order and then the order that they're produced in.
Yeah.
So looking at it from that perspective, if you want to watch it all, then watch all of the original series, but watch The Cage, the original unaired pilot first, then watch the episode where No Man Has Gone Before, which was like the fourth or fifth aired episode, but actually is the first episode, is the first episode of the weekly series. It's the first episode with Kirk in it. It's the first episode where Kirk and Spock first meet, you know. And so if you want to watch it or watch it completely in order, then do that. But just be aware that the order that the original series is listed in is incorrect. So if you just Google it, you'll see the order they're produced in. So I'd just say, if you want to watch all of Star Trek, watch it all, but just make sure that you do it correctly. However, I don't think that's the spirit of the question. I would say that my feeling is, watch Strange New Worlds.
It's great.
Well, no, because you don't need to know anything about Star Trek.
No.
It's really indicative of what Star Trek is. It's a combination of standalones and longer storylines. It's very much rooted in the Gene Roddenberry philosophy of, you know, infinite diversity and infinite combination. The types of types of stories that they tell, which are generally based around moral conundrums, is very Star Trek. But also, it's a modern show, so it looks good. So I think that Strange New Worlds was purpose-built to be in entry-level Star Trek. So I would say that if you're not sure if you're going to like Star Trek, Strange New Worlds is the best way to go.
And yeah, I'd back that up as well, because there's one season of it so far, with however many episodes in that season. So it's not... It doesn't feel impenetrable to watch it.
The only other way I was thinking, though, was exactly what Hannah said, would be if you like The Orville. The Orville is very specifically fashioned on what people call the Rick Berman era of Star Trek, and that basically is The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, Voyager and Enterprise.
Yeah.
So what I would say would be, if that's the route you want to go, if your primary motivation of watching Star Trek is because you like The Orville, then what I would say to you is watch the first and last episodes of season one of the, of The Next Generation. Watch The Measure of a Man and Q Who from season two, and then watch the rest of it from season three, and then watch all of Deep Space Nine. I would say that if you want an Orville-friendly experience, then what I've just said, first and last episode of season one of Next Gen, Q Who, Measure of a Man, then the season three onwards, Deep Space Nine, is basically the Star Trek that the Orville's fashioned on.
And, I mean, the Orville was my gateway into Star Trek, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Like, when the Orville went on its season break, I was really needing that kind of Star Trekian kind of hit. And that's when...
We watched it.
Yeah, Mike suggested to me, So I did it in a bit of a funny way to start with, in that I picked a random episode of season 3 and we just started watching it from that point because I was enjoying it. But I, in my spare time, went back and watched all of season 1 and all of season 2.
Yeah.
And the first few of season 3 that we'd missed.
Yeah.
So that I could say I'd watched all of it.
Yeah, what I would say, one bit of advice I'd give, because I get asked this a lot, is don't feel like you've got to watch everything. Don't feel like it's homework, because it's not impenetrable. It's not like like I've had so many goes at getting into classic comic books, but there's just so much of it. What I would say is, if you watch, my advice is, if you watch Strange New Worlds and you like it, I would say watch the top 10 generally best regarded episodes of the original series, then watch the original series movies. The original series movies are really
brilliant,
accessible. Everybody who watches them likes them. And
I love them.
I think a huge attachment, particularly people of my generation, have of the characters and Kirk and Spock and McCoy, comes from the movies that were made in the '80s.
Yeah. And they are brilliant. I mean, Wrath of Khan is classic.
Yeah, all of
Spock and Voyage Home.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I love that film. Yeah, it's so classic.
The Voyage Home is one of the most entertaining films ever made.
Yeah.
And also Undiscovered Country. That's a really solid film as well. You know,
which one's
that? That's the one where they have to try and make peace with the Klingons, and Kirk and Spock are framed for killing the Klingons, and
they get put on the
ice planet, and
then
it's like a murder mystery with Spock trying to figure out who it was that framed them on the ship, and Kim Cattrall's in it, and but they're really accessible. So I think that if you it depends which way you want to go. If you go the 80s and 90s Star Trek route and watch for Next Gen, then I would say definitely start on season 3 with cherry picked episodes and then go straight through to the end of Deep Space Nine. If you go the Strange New Worlds route, though, it's difficult to jump from Strange New Worlds to Next Gen. I would say, if you like Strange New Worlds, pick the 10 best episodes of the original series, or the 10 most generally well regarded, and then watch the movies. And then I think the Next Gen, going into Next Gen after the movies, works really well.
Yeah.
Because Next Gen, it's very... Well, Next Gen came out of the movies. You know, like the movies, the original Kirk movies were being made at the time when the Next Gen was made. And aesthetically, they're very similar.
Yeah.
You know, they've got like the red tunics and all that kind of stuff. It feels like... So I think that if you watch Strange New Worlds and the Kirk and Spock movies and a few of the original series, and you're like, oh, I'm liking this way, then's the time to go into Next Gen and all the 90s era and all of that. I think that Picard and... I think Discovery is kind of a really great show, but it's probably the least Star Trek-y of all the Star Trek shows in some ways.
Yeah.
And Picard, you have to have seen The Next Generation. It's silly.
Don't watch it if you haven't seen The Next Gen.
It would just be... It's a sequel.
There'd be a lot of stuff that just... you'd be wondering what the hell was going on.
But what I would say, though, is don't underestimate the original 60 series. I think a lot of people skip that because it's the 60 series, but you'd be surprised... Once you've watched a couple of them and you've kind of readjusted to the fact that it's a 60s TV show, they're great. And there's 80 episodes, and, you know, I say pick the best 10, but, I mean, the third season's a bit of a write-off because Gene Roddenberry had left the show and it was just kind of being made for syndication at that point. But there's the first two seasons, there's 30 episodes in each season. So that's 60 episodes. And I would say that every single one of them is very good. But I would say that the... top 10 episodes of the original series is as good as TV gets. You know, I think that your appreciation of all of the other Star Trek will grow because so much of it is... Like, Strange New Worlds does it quite well. There's a lot of references to things that happened in the original series. Discovery does loads of references to things that happened in the original series. But it doesn't matter if you don't know what they are, but it's nice to be kind of in the club, you know. But maybe I could pick a couple of the 60s ones for... I still haven't decided what I'm going to do for our sorbet. But anyway, yes, that's a very long-winded answer. But I would say that if you're unsure, you can do a lot worse than starting with season 3 of Next Gen or watching Strange New Worlds.
Hear, hear.
Yeah. And, you know, if you'd have asked me this question a year ago, I'd probably have said Enterprise.
Yeah.
Enterprise, if you want to learn the basics of Star... Like, the first episode explains who the Klingons are.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't get much more inclusive than that.
Because,
you know?
Enterprise is when, you know...
Well, it's the earliest era of Star Trek we've seen.
Yeah, it's when Earth starts.
Yeah. I mean, if you wanted to watch Star Trek in universe chronological order, you'd start with Enterprise.
Hmm. Yeah, yeah, absolutely would. So,
cool. Anything
good luck
else?
With it. No, that's
okay.
It.
Cool. All right. Well, we are going to hit pause, and then we are going to watch the season finale. That's episode 22 of season 4 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. World's End, and then we will come back and we will discuss. Speak to you shortly.
Bye bye.
Mulberry Boys, every Friday night on the show, you better know they keep it tight. ETL is back and the J-Strom's in the zone. Introduce the co-host, he doesn't do it alone. PCZ is about to hold court. You know he's on the headset, you can hear him snort. Pop culture movies, TV shows and games. Rotten Tomatoes, reviews, news and Blu-rays. Foggy don't play around, he will bust a drop fast. Welcome to the Entertainment Landfill Podcast. The Jason and Steven Show. It's the Jason and Steven Show.
What? What?
The Jason and Steven Show. It's the Jason and Steven Show.
And we're back. So we've just watched World's End, the season finale of season 4 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., the 22nd episode of the season. Hannah, initial thoughts?
Bravo, Jeffrey Bell.
Yeah. And William Gierhart.
And William Gierhart. Mrs. Gierhart.
I like the when all the Johnny Depp and Amber Heard stuff was going on, people were just like, look, Johnny Depp's nearly 60. Shouldn't we be calling him Jonathan Depp by now? I mean, I always think of the bit in Grown Ups. Is it Grown Ups? The Judd Apatow film when Jonah Hill, who's come back from seeing Harry Potter, he's like, Christ, he's like, those kids are getting so old now. He's like, the film should be Harold Potter by now. But anyway, yes, sorry, you were saying.
Oh, it was so well done. Big props to, what's the actor's name? Henry
Fitzsimmons?
I just thought he had such a great arc in this.
Well,
he had
to kind of go from 0 to 60 and back again really quick.
I thought his emotional performance, and in the last episode I was saying about how there's one scene that really sticks in my mind, and it was him and Yo-Yo and Hope sitting on the sofa.
Oh, when she disappears.
And then when she disappears and he just, like, starts to cry feel the emotion of it and really give in to the fact that he's known all along that she's not, quote marks, real.
Yeah, yeah, he's just been hanging on.
Yeah, and, oh, God, he just did such a great job of it.
Yeah.
Hats off to him. I think this was his time to shine.
I think
this episode to really kind of stretch those acting muscles.
I absolutely agree. But I also think that it's a credit to the show that they allow moments like that in a season finale. And a season finale is often a lot of running around and a lot of shouting and a lot of the world's going to end and all that.
Yeah.
And I think that it's important because I think that one of the things that really works for this episode for me is that it's an unusual one because this season is multiple storylines. It almost feels like it's a finale for several seasons because what you've got really is this episode does a number of things. It's the season finale for season 4 of a show.
Yeah.
So it's kind of ending the season and setting up the next season. It's the finale of the framework story arc, but it's also the finale of the two preceding mini arcs as well.
Yeah.
You know, so to do all of that, but also have all of the emotional stuff with Mac, sort of put a nice cap on the Robbie Reyes Ghost Rider stuff and use the mythology behind that character pretty seamlessly as a solution without it feeling like a deus ex machina, you know? It never felt like that.
What does that mean, by the way?
It's the hand of God. It's like when Q appears and clicks his fingers and all the ball ships disappear.
Right.
It's the sci-fi equivalent of it was all a dream, you know? And sometimes, you know, when you have a magical character appear and provide a solution, it can feel like a deus ex machina. But in this instance, I think that because the Ghost Rider storyline is so well developed and kind of integral to this season, it isn't that. And also because this season, because it wasn't two seasons ago, it was earlier this season because of the whole story arcs thing, it meant that they could foreshadow it in that, you know, this idea that both Ghost Rider and Aida are connected to the Darkhold meant that there was narrative connective tissue there, so you didn't feel like, oh, they've written themselves in a corner, let's have the magical guy come and save the day. And also, you know, that's before you even get into just all of the usual fun, quippy stuff. But also, you know, all the stuff with Fitz and Simmons that was very well played as well. It just feels like they did a lot. And I think that it was nice because in some ways it was quite a quiet season finale.
Yeah.
You know, like a lot of the time it's...
It was a much more emotional one.
It was a much more character-driven finale. Yeah.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of the previous seasons have been awesome, but awesome in a bells and whistles, spectacular.
Yeah.
You know, and this must have been an expensive season to make, because usually the way that a TV show works, particularly a network one, is it's the whole idea of you create your standing sets and you use them. So, you know, if you have a story arc for a season, often you'll have sets that are associated with that storyline, and you'll get 22 episodes of usage out of those things. When you do mini arcs, often you'll have to change environments, you know, so that costs. There's a lot of money. Like, I remember seeing something that I never understood until relatively recently was, I was watching a bonus feature on one of the Star Trek The Next Generation episodes, and they were talking about how every time somebody fires a laser beam, that costs $2,000. And so they had to limit them. And I was thinking, well, $2,000 isn't really a lot of money when you consider that, you know, each episode costs probably a couple of million. But what I didn't realise was, they said, yeah, but what you've got to factor in is, let's say that the budget of an episode of Star Trek in the 90s or whenever was $1 million. What you've got to remember is that if all you did in that episode was film the cast sitting silently for 45 minutes on the bridge of the Enterprise, that would cost you $850,000 because of the rental of the building, the money that you're paying the actors, the money that you're paying the grips, the lighting people, the electricity, the power. Yeah. Just to do nothing costs $850. So you've actually only got a budget of 150 grand to actually do stuff, to build things. And that's the way that you have to think about network television.
Yeah.
So every time they say, right, we're going to do six episodes that are set in here, you have to spend money. Whereas if the if you do a season where it's just them on the Zephyr going to places, then you know that there's a set that you can use for probably a third of every episode.
Yeah.
That's gone when you're sort of like jumping around. That's why shows, anthology shows, like, never last. You know, if you're doing a different thing every episode, then you have to build all that shit costume it and all of that kind of stuff. So I think that, I don't know whether it might just have been a budget decision. The fact that, like, okay, we've mapped out the season. We know it's going to be expensive. We know that there's quite a lot of, particularly in those three Ghost Rider arc, it's very cinematic. And a lot of the scale of the almost science fiction-y kind of 28 days later dystopian stuff, that's going to be expensive because you're using a lot of environments that you don't normally use. You know, I mean, there's a reason why sitcoms are set in a coffee shop or a bar, or in Buffy they've got the library, you know. So I think that maybe they were like, well, do we need to have an expensive final episode? Because ultimately, really, the villain is essentially a person, you know, with a couple of extra sort of tufts in tow.
I like that little finger waggle you did.
Well, that's sign language for tufts. And it was. This is how much I think about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because we record these episodes, I edit them, we're doing them every day, so it's just all there. It was like I was in the middle of a meeting at work today, and it's you know, my mind was wandering. But I was sitting there, and I was having this really serious conversation, and my mind, for absolutely no reason, went to, I think I might actually try a vodka and then smell an onion afterwards and see what it's like. And then my mind was like, Mike, you're at work, go back to it. And I was like, okay. So, you know, it's just not vanilla vodka, you know, that's the important thing. But no, I thought that this was a very, very satisfying conclusion to the end of the show. And I would say as well that if you're, and why you would watch four seasons if this wasn't the case, I think that we've talked before about how a lot of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is improved by either binging it or just knowing it's good.
Yeah.
Knowing that the show knows what it's going to do, and that when you're in the middle of these long story arcs, that they're not going to lost. They're not going to pull a J.J. Abrams, you know, on you. But also, I think that by the time you get to the end of season four, I think that there's a very compelling case for this just being an awesome show.
Yeah.
And I think that anybody who watches to the end of season four and then checks out, I just don't understand that.
No, I don't either.
You know, I mean,
especially after this season, because it's so good.
Yeah, I mean, when we watched season five, by our own admission, we kind of started it and then came back to it. But that was more, it wasn't like we were going to stop watching the show.
No.
There's a lot of shows where I've done that, where I've been enjoying them, but I've just drifted away and not been able to come back. But I think that by the time you get to the end of season four, I think that the show has stated its case.
And our you know, decision to leave season five until we had a good chunk of them before we...
It really works like that.
Yeah, and it was more down to what else we were watching and sort of needing headspace for that more than...
Yeah, I mean, because it's probably worth mentioning as well, one of the things that Hannah and I tend to do, and one area where I think we are similar, is that Hannah and I, we go on these almost mini film festival tangents.
Yeah.
Like we'll watch a Tarantino film, enjoy it, and then we will watch all the Tarantino films, and then we'll watch gangster films, and then we'll go for a phase of watching a lot of Mel Gibson movies or whatever. Yeah. And it's almost like sort of programming our entertainment. Sometimes when we step away from something for a while, it's because it doesn't fit whatever tear we're on at that time.
Yeah.
But if a show's good enough, like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is, Better Call Saul's another example of this.
Yeah.
It's finished now. We've not watched any of the last season, but I know we will, and I know we'll love it.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a little bit like, this is a bit cheesy, but it's a little bit like a good friendship, you know, where you know there are certain people who
you've got enough in the bank.
Exactly. Mm. But there are other people who you're really close to, but you don't see for a while, and then you're like, oh, that relationship is just withered. You know, that does happen.
Yeah.
And I think that this show is a very good friend, you know. And I think that by the time you get to the end of the season four, you've, as you say, got enough in the bank in that, you know, that sort of entertainment friendship.
Yeah.
Because I think when you commit to watching a show, you know, it is kind of, you are entering into a bit of a social contract.
Yeah.
And I'm very loyal when it comes to these sort of things.
Oh, me too.
There are so many shows that have ran for like 11 or 12 seasons, and I have watched those fuckers to the end, you know?
Yeah.
I'm the guy who carried on watching The X-Files when Mulder and Scully weren't in it.
Yeah.
You know? You watched How I Met Your Mother and Modern Family to the end,
to
you know?
To the bitter end.
So, should we get into this? Should we break it down? Sure. We open up with straight from the previously, we go into Robbie reappearing and going to get his car. We see May teasing Coulson about drinking the whiskey. There's something kind of endearingly schoolyard about their relationship. Like the fact that they can't talk. It's like they're too embarrassed to talk about sex, so they hide behind the, we're going to have that whiskey, you know. And it's just, there's something kind of endearingly sort of childish and infantile about the way that they relate to each other.
And the fact that whenever they're having an intimate conversation, they don't do it really facing each other. They do it walking side by side, or like, it's sort of like a high school relationship.
Well, because Coulson always gives May kind of shit about being emotionally cut off, but He's as bad as she is, but he fronts about it.
His is through losing people he's loved.
Well, and also the way that they both repress it is different. Is that May represses it by being a hard ass, and Coulson uses humour as a defence mechanism.
Yeah.
He kind of just Chandlers his way through it.
Yeah.
Fitz tells Gemma about how they made the human Aida, as a bit of intel, and he's listing all of the evil stuff and kind of his self-flagellation kind of going on there.
Oh, he's saying, you know, it was me.
Yeah, he's got the, it's a vanilla vodka hangover kind of stuff going on there, isn't it?
It's got the beer for you.
And basically what Simmons says is, she's like, look, I haven't got time for this shit, just, how do we kill her? You know, be useful. And then she says, do you want to kill her?
Yeah.
You know?
And that's a really valid point, because it's like, you know, these are real memories that he has. You know, he's essentially lived that life.
Well, it's, I mean, it's traumatizing, isn't it? And I think also, just regardless of the immorality of what you're doing, just the emotional impact of going from one reality to another, just that, even if you are perfectly lovely and wonderful but just had a different life, just dealing with that transition would be really unprecedented, you know? So we see that the team are trying to deal with Yo-Yo, of course, because she plugged herself into the Matrix at the end of the last scene. They see that something's happening in the framework. Radcliffe saves Yo-Yo, and we see that he keeps finding Yo-Yos in his pocket.
In his pockets,
and it's kind of like, that's a very Star Trek-y thing, a little bit like, you know, when they've got the time loop episode, and Data is the only one he can remember. So he just sends recurring instances of the number three through. So, you know, so when Data in the past looks up and sees the three pips on Riker, he knows to listen to what Riker says, and not, he sends like a subconscious clue back to himself in the past.
Yeah.
It feels like that. It's one of those kind of like conceits. So we see that Aida wants Fitz to suffer. We see Robbie rock up, and he says, I've come for that. And he points at there. And I think it's funny as well. We talked before about how Gabriel Luna's got like a natural charisma. When he pops up in that scene, and I don't mean to be, I'm not being critical of the actor, but the guy who plays Ivanov, when you see Gabriel Luna turn up in the scene with him, the difference is like night and day.
Oh, of course it is.
It's like, a film star has walked into this thing. and it is one of those weird, it's a difficult thing to talk about, because it's that thing like, I don't know, like Harrison Ford or
he's got that. The X Factor.
It's just the thing. And I think that, you know, people who are like that, it's not even necessarily about acting ability. I mean, you can have acting ability, you can not have acting ability, and, you know, that's the craft, that's what you learn, and that's just how much time you put into it. But I think that that sort of X Factor thing, it must make it easy for you in some ways as an actor, because people can see that. You know, like if you're in a stage production or if you're auditioning, there are some people who just sort of shine that little bit more brightly. And It's just so apparent, particularly, I think, because the character's been away from the show for a while. To suddenly have him come back into the middle of his storyline, you're just like, oh, wow, okay.
I like the fact that his moustache is just a wee bit longer, and, like, he looks like he needs a little bit of a trim. You
know,
like, he looks slightly on the dishevelled side.
Yeah. Well, hell of a do that to you, ain't it?
Yeah. But I like that they've done it quite subtly.
Yep.
Like, he doesn't come back looking absolutely
the same,
cream crackered or the same.
Yeah, there's a different. But it's funny as well, because, like, and also he talks a little bit about the sort of the idea of hell, and this sort of speaks to the larger Marvel mythology, not necessarily the larger MCU mythology, but just this idea that hell isn't necessarily, you know, this, you know, Michelangelo view.
It's subjective.
It's a place, and, you know, we already know by this point in the MCU, you know, with Guardians of the Galaxy and things like this, that we've got this interstellar, a cosmic universe, and then you've got the weird magic side of it, like the Darkhold and Doctor Strange and Scarlet Witch and all that.
You know, at the end,
the portal
chains. Make a portal
like Doctor Strange. Absolutely.
You know, that was really cool.
Yeah, and it's like what Aida was doing as well when she was building that. It was all very much part of that same sort of like aesthetic. But the idea being that, you know, there are these dark places or realms, and whether you want to call them, you know, dimensions or planets or, you know, whether you want to look at them conceptually or geographically is kind of irrelevant, you know. And I think that's interesting because I think that it's important for the show to clarify, look, we're not talking about, like, you know, he went to a fiery place, you know, with like a red guy with horns and a tail and a pitchfork kind of thing.
Yeah.
But it's something, it's a little bit like when we're talking about soul, this idea of this other sort of ethereal part of yourself. Because obviously one of the themes of this season very much is the idea of identity and memory and decisions and what makes you a person. You know, even in the Ghost Rider storyline with all the stuff about his brother and choosing your own destiny and your path and how that affects other people and, you know, the butterfly effects and all of that, you know, I think it's important that they clarify that when they talk about something like hell, that's metaphorical in the sense that when they talk about soul, they're not specifically talking about the Judeo-Christian idea of soul. They're talking about the intangible essence of a person beyond psychology and physiology.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So we see that he fire chains some of the Russian toughs, the tough bots. He gets really angry as well. And you know why that is, don't you?
Because he cannot abide.
That's right, Hannah. Talbot says that that the word about Mace is out. You know, the idea that he wasn't really an inhuman. So basically what's happening is S.H.I.E.L.D.'s reputation has just gone to shit again.
Yeah.
You know, and really they're essentially on the lam in the same way that they were back in the Trip days. You know,
mean they shout out and cause some doubt?
What do you mean?
About Ace Mace.
Oh, oh, we're back there, are we? Jesus Christ.
Well, it's the final episode. We've got to have a little bit of
a little encore. So basically, S.H.I.E.L.D. are screwed. They, I like the when Daisy goes to see Robin, he's just sat there and she's like, how you doing? He's like, not bad. Beat up a couple of dudes who turned out to be robots.
Yeah.
Ada's not healing herself as the ghost was born in the same world as her. So what we're seeing is that he can kind of kryptonite.
He's a chink in her armour.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So Yo-Yo and Radcliffe go to see Mac. Mac doesn't want anything to do with reality, as it were. Hope speaks to Yo-Yo. So you see Yo-Yo starting to be like, okay, I can see why this would be a problem here. We're seeing that people are starting to vanish. It's all very rapture-y.
Well, people, but more property is like it's subtle to start with.
The world's being erased.
Yeah.
We see that the...
It was my nostril.
Oh, was it?
Sorry.
I thought it was more talking. We learned that at the S.H.I.E.L.D. inquiry, a guest has been replaced by a robot and he's bringing Ivanov. He goes into the meeting and shows them the Darkhold. I like the "I smell a load of Elrond horse crap."
Yeah, that was an excellent line.
And faux Daisy walks in and shoots Talbot in the head. He amazingly survives.
Yeah. I hadn't remembered that, but I love that they use the Daisy bot in that way. Like, you know, how are we going to cause doubt about S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Yes.
You know. Just another way to bring that middle arc.
And also, we saw loads of Daisy bots earlier in the season as well, didn't we? And it's a bit like, is it Chekhov's gun? The idea that if you introduce a gun, it has to be used. So, you know, Chekhov's Daisy bot is in this instance. And they leave the Darkhold when they're trying to escape. Daisy and Robbie fight a bunch of bots. And I like the fact that when the Russian appears, she's like, really? You again? And I'm like, I'm right there with you, Daisy.
I like the fact that he implies he's the last one by saying it doesn't matter if you kill this body, I'll just create more.
Yeah.
Because obviously he's still ahead
somewhere,
controlling everything.
Yeah.
But
it's a way of knowing that he's gone.
Well,
basically he's gone.
Basically the implication is if you destroy this one, he's a bit screwed, especially if Aida is no longer around.
Yeah, if the means of production are gone. Yeah. I like the fact that when Daisy and Robbie kick ass, Coulson runs in, he's like, I missed it, didn't I?
Total fanboy, missed it.
And that's very much part of the kind of geek Coulson personality that kind of bubbled to the surface when we saw his sort of his teacher alter ego, but of course that we saw in the earlier Marvel films, you know, the card collecting kind of Steve Rogers fanboy, you know.
And I love in this episode that you kind of have a wee bit of a flirty energy going on between Daisy and Robbie.
Yeah.
But it's borderline whether it's flirting in terms of anything kind of romantic or if it's flirting in a, can you imagine the two of us teamed up?
And, exactly. I mean, it feels as much like just a kind of a kinship.
Yeah.
Like the fact that they're very similar.
It's a bit like the banter that Falcon and Winter Soldier have in their TV show.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. And the what we learn is that this whole kind of frame job that Ada's doing is basically the same tactic that she used in the framework, whereas in the framework she used the girl who survived Bahrain to demonize the Inhumans and kind of weaponize all of the kind of the hatred and to create that climate of fear. But in this instance, it's the incident with Daisy, because obviously Daisy had been built up by Mace, and Mace has been discredited now, so she's become the poster child for S.H.I.E.L.D. being sketchy, you know.
Ace Mace is now a disgrace.
Yes, he's lost face. So the wants to basically, she wants to create the world, that world in real life. She wants to create the world. She wants to make the real world the framework.
Yeah.
Coulson wants to use the dark.
Sorry to interrupt you. Did you notice she's also started calling Fitz rather than Leopold?
Who has?
Ada.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I did notice that, yeah. So Coulson wants to use the Darkholder's bait. He says, you know, I'm tired of hiding. And that's the bit you always got to get in the kind of, either the climax of the film at the end, the kind of like, I'm going to take the fight to them. It's always like, hell yeah. So they're going to go back to the HQ. Mac and the crew are trying to leave town. Yo-Yo speaks to Mac. Everyone's vanishing. Mac comforts his daughter. Radcliffe tells her, basically, that he would... that Mac would never forgive her being Yo-Yo, for forcing him out, and that he's willing to die in there with Hope. Hope overhears this, rather unfortunately. Ada rocks up. Fitz tries to reason with her, and she stabs Simmons. Did you remember that this was a fake out?
No, I hadn't.
No, I hadn't either.
And I love that they kind of use her technology against her.
Yep.
Like, she thinks it is the real Simmons.
Yeah, fished in. Coulson tells May about the Maybot. Ada comes for the book, and Gemma shoots her. It's a fake out. And I like the fact that it cuts to, I love the shorthand, it cuts to Fitz wiping his eyes, like, I don't need these tears anymore. Okay, place these back in my pocket where I don't need them. Probably, it would have been his waistcoat pocket if it was evil Fitz, wouldn't it? Next to his little watch thing.
Yeah.
So Coulson becomes the Ghost Rider, and Portal fights with Ada and does her in. We see the daughter immediately grasses up Yo-Yo to Mac, and the door appears.
I'm not real.
Yeah. Basically, Yo-Yo says that she'll stay, and the daughter vanishes. And that's the moment that you said as well, where Mac just basically sort of has the breakdown. And it's funny as well, because we had kids when this episode was first on. I've talked a lot on this podcast about how watching stuff that's about parental grief or child endangerment is different. But I don't remember it affecting me that much when I first saw it. And I think it was because our kids were that much younger.
Yeah.
And I think that because our kids are much closer in age now to Hope, I think it's much more, like, our children...
Found it far more visceral this time.
And I think it's because it's the thing that affected me about watching it emotionally was the daughter wanting comfort and saying, is it going to be okay? And I think that our kids now are old enough for us to have had conversations like that with them.
And the whole, I want to be real, like, I can imagine Chloe saying that to you or me, like when she gets us to...
Like when she found out she was a robot that time.
When she gets us to put our hand on her chest to check that her heart's still beating.
Yeah, and when she asks us if her head's going to come off.
I know.
I mean, I should have responded with, oh, God, I hope not. Do you think it is?
Would have freaked out if he'd said something like that.
I doubt it.
But I kind of think, like, kids around that age, you know, they are thinking about their mortality and...
Well, also, at that age, parents, you don't know what's real and what isn't. Like, yeah. You're told that monsters aren't real, but you're told that Santa Claus is and that he flies. So you're kind of like, well, hang on. So the world is just this awesome, wonderful place full of promise, but it's also full of the terror and fear that comes with boundless imagination, you know? Yeah. And that's a exciting, wondrous, subtle and gross place to traverse, you know?
I like the fact that...
And I think the other thing as well is that you see a tear come from Mac in his unconscious state as well.
One thing I think was really great and probably the decider for him to leave the world, because I don't think he would have left even when Hope had died if Yo-Yo hadn't have stayed and said... You're the most important person to me, so I'm just going
to
stay.
Well, he essentially left to save her life.
Yeah, like but also I think that realization that he has love and connection and family,
but also
whatever that looks like in the other world.
But also that he would be putting her through what he's just gone through by not coming back.
And once he's through, like... He's kind of had, like, I mean, this sounds terrible, but he's kind of had the best experience, because before the framework, he hadn't had any experience of Hope as a child because she'd died as a baby. Yet now he's had, you know, 10 years with her, or however old she
is. And what we do see is that it's different for different people, but the reality of the framework does fade quite quickly, even though the effects might linger. You know, it's not like you have this period of still thinking it's real, you know, so there is that sort of, you know, division. And that's why I think the actor does such a good job, because it's a very compressed set of emotions, not because I think that the pacing's bad or that they haven't given it enough time in the story, but because of the science fiction element of it.
Yeah,
you know, the 100%. Fact that it's like the obvious comparison is The Inner Light, you know, the Star Trek episode where Picard has his entire lifetime. And, you know, Patrick Stewart has to basically play the entire life of this character and then play the regular character who has just woken up having experienced that, you know. And I think that you need somebody who can do a lot. And, you know, when you think of the actor who plays Mac, you know, you think of his physicality.
Yeah.
You think of the fact that he's, you know, a likeable actor, you know, good actor. But I think that for somebody who probably has been cast as just a lot of heavies, or dare I say toughs, you know, probably hasn't been cast in roles that have a huge amount of emotional depth because of the connotations of his physicality. Then, I mean, I've seen him in other things, and he always seems to play... He's played a lot of characters who have the curly wire in their ear and talking to their cuffs to protect presidents and, you know, that kind of thing. So I think that he just does a great job of it and really, you know, kind of solidifies...
I thought he was wonderful
because,
in this.
Because, I mean, and again, you know, this is a character who hasn't been in the show since the beginning of it, and there's always that, you know, there's that joke about the... you know, the guy who was born on a boat that was moored at an island, and then he's brought onto the island, you know, right after he's born. And then in his 30s and 40s, people still call him a newcomer to the island because he wasn't born there, but he was born 10 feet off. And TV shows can be like that. You know, art can be like that, where it's kind of like bands, you know, music bands are like that. You know, you're a new guy, even though you've been in the band for... It's like the bass player of Metallica, people still refer to him as the new guy. He's been in the band for 20 years, you know. He's been in the band longer than any of their other bass players, but he's the new guy, you know. And I think that Mac's a very likable character and has had a lot of fun stuff to do. But I think that after this, there's no distinction between him and the rest of the team as far as, you know, him being like a second-tier character.
Of his character.
Yeah, it's like, it feels like it's the final step.
Yeah.
In that, I like the fact that when he wakes up,
he's part of the A-team.
Yeah, and I think that when he wakes up, he does that thing that everybody does, that you know, the kind of the worst
one. I do that when the kids wake me up. Like, it's the weirdest thing. Sometimes I think that I scare them more when they wake me up in the middle of the night because I do have that kind of reaction.
No, I think you scare them more when you do your weird kind of noise that you do. Hannah, when Hannah has nightmares, she makes a sound that sounds like somebody doing a mocking impression of a scared old woman. Like, like the Holy Ghost is. And
not on purpose, by the way.
I hope not.
In my dreams, I'm absolutely screaming my head off.
You know what it sounds like? It sounds like you've had a really nasty attack of the willies. Like, specifically the willies. It's like a... like you're dreaming that you're being chased by some kind of Caspery looking ghost. But anyway, so Coulson says that he couldn't imagine staying as Ghost Rider.
Yeah.
And when he's asked, he says that he will tell the others why he made the deal eventually.
Yeah.
So what we see is that obviously, seemingly, Coulson made some kind of deal or arrangement with the ghost that was inhabiting Robbie, and that his side of the deal is something untoward and mysterious that presumably is going to play a big part in the next season. It's funny, I made a note here, and I don't know if I remembered it, because obviously they do it later in the episode, but it's not a post-credit scene. I said, but there should have been a post-credit scene of just Radcliffe on his own, just walking around like, oh, great, it's just fucking me now. But they do actually kind of do that, and I think it's great.
I like that they didn't forget
about Radcliffe, because he's been in the whole season. He's actually been quite... And I'd forgotten how much he was in it. And I like the fact that the show can't resist redeeming characters when they can.
Yeah.
You know, Ward's a classic example of that. Fitz... You know, he's hopefully going to be a classic example of that. But I like the fact that in the end, Radcliffe did grow a pair and did the right thing. He had to die to come to that. So Robbie takes the book. And again, he says to Daisy, will you keep an eye on my brother? And I think it's nice that they didn't need to mention that.
Mm.
You know, they could have. But it's such a part of his character that's the, oh, they forgot to mention Law in the data episode moment. That's the writers reminding us that they know what they're doing, that they understand the mythology and the characters of their universe, and that Robbie would say that. Mm. And if we have to stop the scene for a second, because that's what you always hear, well, we didn't want to include that dialogue because we stopped the scene dead. Mm. It's like, well, you do it well.
Yeah.
And they did. You know, it's like, if you've got a good actor in the role and you write the scene well, nobody will care if you stop the scene to reference a character that character would be referencing.
It feels far more authentic.
Yeah. I mean, he's not going to just forget about his brother because it's the season finale, you know. And that was such an important part of the character as well, because, I mean, if you look back on it, you know, a big part of the storyline, the Robbie Ray storyline, was the idea that, you know, people get forgotten.
Mm.
You know, people get left behind by society.
Yeah.
And I think it would be a disservice to the spirit of that storyline if they forgot to mention this character again. He says to Coulson, I don't envy you. And May, you see May clock that, you know, what's this? Mm. You know, we'll have no more talk of this bizarre conspiracy. So we see that Talbot's in a coma and that they need to do a runner again. Fitz wants to stay and take the hit. And there's a really nice moment where the team all come together and say, nope, you need to come with me. We're all in this together. You know, we're family. That's the theme.
And Daisy sort of referencing how she tried to do that. And I dyed my hair. That's the season
coming full circle, isn't it? That's the season started with, you know, Avril Lavigne fan looking...
Yeah.
You know, her, when she met up with Robbie and all that. Shouting
about why everything is so complicated.
Yeah, and I think in a weird way that kind of exchange, that kind of, is it romantic, is it just a kind of understanding between Robbie and Daisy, it feels like both of those characters have found some, not necessarily peace, but a certain amount of self-awareness and understanding that life isn't perfect, but they, at least now, they're not operating from a place of pain. They're on the path that they want to be on, you know.
I think also it's reinforcing what we have said time and time again through the various seasons, that the show is at the core of it about family.
Yeah, about found family.
Yeah. And they're just reinforcing that Fitz has a family who aren't going to leave him.
Everybody, you know, fucks up.
And part of loving someone is loving them unconditionally.
Yeah.
You know, and like you might not be happy about some things.
Yeah. Well, sometimes you've got to give them a slap, haven't you?
They need to do work on themselves, but it doesn't mean you don't care about them and love them and want to keep them close and support them.
But crucially, what Daisy says, the thing that actually gets through to him is she said, it was you that pulled me back in.
Mm.
And she says, this is not on you, and there's nothing to apologise for.
Yeah.
And I like the fact that Coulson just breaks attention with, like, well, is anybody hungry?
Yeah, yeah.
I bet he's just somebody who would appreciate finding gammon steak in a hospital. So we see Radcliffe watching a sunset on the beach, and he says, oh, this is how the world ends, not with a bang, but with a... And then the sand drops, and you see the glass sort of...
Did it make you want whiskey to see it fall into the sand?
No, it made me want to sit on the beach, though. with John Hannah, I bet he could tell some stories. Oh.
Maybe we'll sit on the beach tomorrow when we go for brunch together.
I can't, because of my eye.
Oh, that's right. I was only really kidding. I don't really want to sit on the beach.
Oh, okay.
It's winter.
You weren't kidding about brunch, though, were you?
No, I'm not kidding about brunch. God. We're doing brunch.
Okay. I didn't know whether, because we went out for a meal the other night, that had superseded brunch.
No. Hell no. Good. We're totally doing brunch.
Good, good. Okay, sorry about that, listeners. We don't actually get much time to talk to each other these days between podcasts.
This is actually the first time we've spoken to each other properly all day.
Yeah, this isn't even... How are you, Hannah?
Yeah, I'm good. How are you?
I'm fucking terrible. I'll tell you after... No, I'm just joking. Everything's fine. So we see them in a diner. It's all very Twin Peaksy. They're waiting for their pie. The lights go out, and I like how resigned they are. Like, Coulson's like, okay, here we go. And then they get frozen. We see a bald-headed figure behind them. And then we see Coulson wake up in space, but weirdly not seem that surprised about it, which is compelling.
Enough sightseeing, it's time to get back to work.
So, and there we go. Any final thoughts, Hannah, before we wrap things up?
Oh, it was so good. I enjoyed the season far more second time around. I think this season just so benefited from a rewatch. I really loved it.
I think how quickly we watched it is testimony to that.
Yeah, 100%. I just, you know, you have to applaud the cast. They really had the run of it this season. Yeah.
And loads of great guest cast. I mean, Mallory Jansen, who played... Aida, John Hannah, Gabriel Luna, you know, I mean, these are people who any one of them could carry their own show.
These are heavy hitters to have as guest stars. And, you know, they just absolutely smashed it out of the park.
And immediately as well. It wasn't one of those, I'm starting to warm to this character. It was like, right, you belong in the show. It's probably worth mentioning a quick little bit of housekeeping that I forgot to mention. Obviously, we finished the season 4, so we're going to do our sorbet episodes. Our next episode is our 100th episode, so I would, again, please do send us feedback. It would be great if we could have a feedback segment in the next episode. And before we start on the...
And we'll probably be recording that episode on the weekend.
Yep.
So just in case you're timing your feedback.
Yep. So we would appreciate feedback for that episode. We're going to do maybe a little bit of extra special content on that we're still working up for the 100th episode. But we would like to have some feedback on that. So if you could email that to rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, whether that's voicemail or written, that would be great. And then we will get on to our sorbet episode. So I can't speak for Hannah, but I haven't completely decided what I'm going to do yet, but it's essentially, I would suggest
probably... Are we going to go the same kind of route that we did in the last...
Well, I think that we'd have two things each.
Okay.
And what they are is completely up to us.
Okay.
So just in case people have joined the show late, what we mean is we will have a few episodes where we will step away from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and replenish. We'll pick a... maybe a couple of pilot episodes. That's one option that we go with sometimes, pilot episodes, or maybe a two-part miniseries like we did with V, or maybe a couple of notable episodes of shows that, you know, maybe we're not going to get to anytime soon, but we want to talk about.
Yeah.
And we'll probably be able to, I think, let you know what at least some of those are in the next episode. But rest assured, we will be returning with season 5 of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. At the rate we're going... pretty bloody soon. I would imagine
we're loving it, and we're loving, you guys feeding back into us and having fun with it.
Yeah, I wouldn't imagine we'll be away from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. longer than a couple of weeks, to be honest.
No,
I think that we'll be. I think that if we're doing four sorbet episodes between us, I think that it's conservatively we're going to do
pretty quick.
Conservatively we're going to do two a week, aren't we? So but there we are. So feedback appreciated. rewatchprojectpodcast@gmail.com, and we will be back with you very soon. Bye bye.
Take care.